Today we're in a great new series. I love this series because I wrote a book about it. And if you don't have that book, you can get it. Can I Get a Witness? But today we're going to be opening the series, and I'm just going to sort of walk through those first couple chapters. They're really, really, really important. I didn't realize that when I was writing the book that we could be in these incredible times we're in now. To give opportunity to God to use us in a great and powerful way. But that's where we are. Today, my subject is, say it with me, stop the press. Stop the press, stop the press. That was one of the words I used last Sunday morning at 8 o'clock, reading some things that weren't exactly what we wanted to portray. I'm like, whoa, stop the press. We didn't agree to this. But once your news is out there, people will interpret it the way they see it. So instead of allowing people to interpret what we are doing here at Ambassadors Worship Center, what our heart is, I just figured we'd just tell them. And now I'm going to remind you what the heart is. Amen. And what God is saying and what God wants from us. Stop the press. This is from and in the Can I Get a Witness series. So we're going to go to Matthew 24, just Matthew 24 today, and talk about the process in which Jesus is training his disciples about what's coming next. You good? Okay, now Jesus is in the temple. If you read the chapter before this, and you might study it this week. Good morning, Pastor Linnell. If you read the chapter before this, Jesus is talking about vipers and beware and woe to you Pharisees, for you do this stuff. You make it hard on people and you can't do it yourself. Woe to you Pharisees, because you give your tithe of cumin, but you forget righteousness. So a lot of Christians say they love Jesus, but they don't care anything about righteousness. And the Bible says justice. Okay, that's what he's talking about in the chapter before. But his disciples are not in the temple while he's talking. Because he's talking to magistrates. He's talking to judges. He's talking to the priests. None of his disciples were priests. Did y'all know that? So none of his disciples were priests. They weren't men of God. They weren't men of the cloth necessarily, right? So he's in there talking to the scribes and the Pharisees, and he's saying, woe unto you. So when he comes out of the temple, his disciples are waiting on him. And while they're waiting for him, they're admiring how beautiful the temple looks. The building, the structure, the architecture, how the stone is put together. It was an amazing place. Till the Romans burn it down. Okay? It's an amazing place. So now he's coming out. They're meeting him, and this is how it goes. Verse 1 says, then Jesus went out and departed from the temple. He's leaving the temple. And his disciples came up to show him the buildings of the temple, which he was just in. And Jesus said to them, while they're saying, wow, isn't this a beautiful place? Jesus says, do you not see all of these things? Assuredly, I say to you, not one stone shall be left here upon the other that shall not be thrown down. They're admiring a structure that's impenetrable, built of stone, powerful, a monument of architecture. It's an amazing place. And Jesus says, all of this you see, that strong and this religious place, he simply says to them, in the vernacular, he's saying to them, religion is going to fall. Everything you think this temple represents is going to fail. And I can tell you today, put it in your notes, everything that's religious and not righteous will fall. And it's falling now. Everything, this beautiful temple, this beautiful religious system, this beautiful way to preach Christ and leave part of it out, everything about that is going to fall. It's going to fail. So don't try to preserve it as it starts to fall. I know I'm making sense already. Don't believe in it. Don't defend it. Don't try to prop it up. Don't put a face on it. Let God do what he's doing with you. Religion in your heart and in your head and in your spirit, so that you can know God for yourself. Moving on. So now they're saying to Jesus, we need you to explain this, because this, it took us 50 years to build this temple. It's the stalwart of our belief system. The scribes and the Pharisees have been teaching us these laws by then for 2,000 years. So what are you talking about, Jesus? All this is going to fall apart. That makes absolutely no sense to us. So they say, explain. They ask three questions in the next verse. Let's read the next verse. It says, now as he sat by the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately, and they said to him, this is what we want to know. Tell us, when will these things be? And what will be the sign of your coming, second coming, and of the end of the age? So we want to know what, when, and how will it all end? What's going to be the sign? How are we going to know that the world is coming to an end? How are we going to know when Jesus is coming? How are we going to really know when things are getting bad and it's going to fall apart? What's the prediction? Will it be things that are happening in our world like it's happening right now? And so saints and people are praying, come soon, Lord Jesus. Is this a sign? Is this something we should be concerned about? So Jesus is saying to them, the end of the age. What is the end of the age? What's the end of this period? What's the end of this time? And we know something else bigger is coming. So this is what Jesus says. Let's start reading it. He's going to make it plain. Tell it. Tell Jesus. Please, please make it plain. We need to be plain to us so we can see it and understand it. Y'all still here? You're listening, huh? Okay, watch this. He says, now, watch this now. Take heed, and I'm going to explain each one of these. That's what I'm going to do today. I'm going to go verse by verse. I hope you don't mind me teaching a little bit. I'm going to go verse by verse so we get it. You got to be wolf-proof now. When you go out into this world and when you're reading stuff and listening to stuff, you got to understand what's happening, AWC. That's who we are. Am I clear? Because God is looking for a witness. Watch this. Take heed that no one deceives you. Whoa. There's going to be the possibility of deception. Take heed that no one deceives you. Why? Read it. For many will come in my name saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive. Watch what Jesus is saying. He's saying people are going to come and they're not going to say, it's not like me saying, Martin, I am the Christ. They're going to come pointing to Jesus and saying, Jesus is the Christ. So do what I say. You better watch it. They will say, Jesus is the Christ, and I'm preaching to you about him and what he said. I'm the one that's telling the truth. And if you don't follow the truth I tell you, you are no longer serving the Christ. So some people will hear somebody say, Martin is the anointed one from Christ. Do what he says. Write this down. Don't you ever follow a man. I don't care who he is. Because none of us are the Christ. He is the Christ. He's the leader of his house. He's the leader of his church. I am the Christ, so do what I say. That's when deception will happen. You'll start doing things that other people say is Christian-like, and it's not in the Bible. Am I clear? I love y'all so much, I'm going to tell you the truth. Now watch what he says now. So religion is misleading. And me, Pastor Martin, nor any other man or woman who stands here, nor anybody in any public office, nor anybody anywhere in the world, none of us are the Christ. Martin is anointed, so do everything he says. You better, You better know how to pray in the Holy Ghost. You better know how to read your Bible. And you better know how to bring your family together and make sure that everybody knows what God is doing. Not me, not a man, not anybody. You better figure out what he is doing. Am I clear? Telling you the truth. So watch what he says in the next verse. This is so good. He says, and you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled. For all these things must, I'm going to break this one down. Wars in this scripture means battles, strife, and discontentment. He says you're going to hear about wars in other nations, in families' houses, in neighborhoods, all over the world. You're going to hear about these wars of strife, contention. You're going to hear about these wars, these battles over different ideas. You're going to start to hear of them. But he says this. He says this about these battles. Don't be troubled by the battles. Don't be troubled about the division. Don't be troubled by any of that that's going on. Because in the Greek it says this, for all of these systems must fall. The English says to us, for all these things must come to pass. But that's English, which is a limited language compared to the Hebrew. In the Hebrew says, don't worry about it. I told y'all this was going to fall apart. He's in a conversation with his disciples. He said in the beginning, all this is going to fall. Now he's at a particular point in his teaching, and he says, don't worry about that because I already told you it's supposed to fall apart. Tell your neighbor, tell yourself, don't prop up nothing God is causing to fall. Yeah, God's trying to let it fall, and you propping it up with duct tape and baling wire and super glue. You're just trying to hold it together. Because you're depending on it. God never wanted you to depend on religion. He wanted you to depend on him. So that day and night you have to pray. Day and night you have to read your Bible. Day and night you have to be in the face of God. Day and night you have to ask him, what is your kingdom? How does it work? What is my part in it? You have to ask him. You have to be in his face and not listening to folks. Watch what he says now. Don't worry about the strife. Don't worry about the wars. Don't worry about the battles. That's why everybody in the world wants a nuclear bomb. Then he says, but the end is not yet. In other words, write this down. The end is not yet. Write this down. These are not signs of the end. And I know everybody's prophesying. There are wars, so Jesus must be coming. Okay, y'all gonna be like that. Okay, there's strife. Jesus is on his way back. Can't you hear him? He's warming up the chariots. Jesus is on his way. These ain't signs. From his mouth, this is in red in your Bible. Jesus is saying, these are not signs of my coming. Your little wars won't make me come. Your little political systems, your little hospital and medical systems, your little education systems, all this stuff you doing down here, all y'all, all this little stuff you done put together for people, Jesus said, none of that mess is going to make me come back. I'm not motivated by the mess you started. You can't move me around like a pawn on the chessboard because you think I need to come back and rescue you. No, I sent you there for a reason. And I need you to complete your reason for being here. Somebody say, can I get a witness? Don't go church on me now. So watch this now. For nation will rise up against nation. This is Jesus talking. This is not me. This is not you. This is not the United Nations. This is not UNICEF. This is not some international organization. This is Jesus who built the whole thing. He says, for nation will rise against nation. You got to see the definition of nation. Put it up on the screen. This definition of nation, and please check me, fact check me, get your Bible, get your concordance. You ain't even got to buy one now. They're free on the internet. This word nation means a race of people. It could mean a nation of people or the nations. It means people joined by practicing similar customs or common culture. So certain people of certain cultures will start fighting one another. And these nations can even be in one household. You can have different nations in one house with different customs and beliefs and theories and what they really hold dear. So in the house, there are nations at war. In the neighborhood, there are nations at war. In the city, there are nations at war. In the state, in the country, in the world, there are nations at war. People who believe a certain way and disagree with others who believe something different. And they let those little differences separate them. Nations. Now watch this. And kingdom against kingdom. Y'all still good? This word kingdom means sovereign, royal power, or a country. So not just in our homes, you're going to have kingdoms, different countries that come against one another in those times. And while all these countries are coming together, something worse happens. Y'all just read it for yourself. And there will be famines, pestilence, plagues. There's going to be earthquakes in weird places. That's just supernatural stuff happening on the earth. Listen to this. He says famines, plagues right now. That would be East Africa. The locusts are eating everything. These pests are eating everything. Famines. People are hungry all over the world, including your world down the street from you. You may not be living in the places where people are hungry, but that don't mean people are not hungry. And you can take the attitude, as long as it's not happening to me, it is none of my business. Well, you are your brother's keeper. Yes, all of them. Look at your neighbor and say, hey, cousin. Now, I got some cousins I don't necessarily like hanging out with either. But I'm your cousin. You got to deal with me. Now, watch this. But listen to what he says. Read it. All these things are just the beginning of sorrow. Hunger, plagues, the shaking of all norms, everything you stood on, believed in, will begin to shake apart, making you feel vulnerable, out in the open, exposed, fearful. And quarantines don't help. Now you're stuck in your house listening to yourself. And the other silly people in your house. I'm sorry. Maybe I'm just talking about my house. We have to work through it. What'd that mean? What'd you mean by that? You know, I don't agree with that. So let's fuss about this. We're in the house. Stuck in the house. So we have to deal with our own idiosyncrasies. What we really believe about ourselves and one another. Because we've never had this opportunity. And trust me, ladies and gentlemen, it's an opportunity. Take it. Have the hard discussions. The impossible stuff, the weird stuff. Talk about it now. Because when you come out of this thing, God's going to be expecting something from you. Where am I at? Watch this. And then they will, you're going to love this. And then they will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you. And you will be hated by all nations. But it's for my name's sake. Here's what that scripture means. Are you okay? You got the palette for this? It means, go ahead and put it up, guys. It means that some are going to turn you over to be destroyed. People you used to fellowship with. People you used to have relationship with. Regardless of what that relationship was, it simply means that some are just going to give you over and say, yep, yep, you can do that. You can do that to them. We don't care. You can have your way with them. We don't really care. And no one's going to say anything to defend you. Mm-mm. Then, and then many will be offended. Raise your hand if you've had to deal with just offended people. Just offended. Just what happened? Offense right now is ripe and rife. Offended over nothing. That used to not make a difference. But now little things offend. Watch what he says now. Watch what he says. They will not only be offended, but offense will lead to betrayal. And betrayal will lead to hatred. Relationships with people I was in love with now hate me. And I'm still in love with them. That's weird. I would never want to go through divorce. I'm just telling you right now. I'm going to follow this chick everywhere. I'm telling you. And some of you, my precious dear ones, we've walked through divorce together. I don't know what it would be like to still be in love with Linnell and she not be in love with me but hates me. That's hell on earth. Thank you, baby. I was waiting for an amen over there in this corner. Jesus, I was just standing here. I forgot y'all were here. I was just like, okay, is she going to say something or what's going to happen? Woo! Okay. Yes, Lord. So, read what the Bible says describes this word, offense. It literally means to be caught in a snare. What Satan wants for you, listen to me, AWC, listen to me. Please, don't let this get you in the next few months. Don't get caught in the snare of offense. Refuse to be offended by anybody. It doesn't matter what they say, just don't, because once you're trapped in offense, it will lead you to betray those you loved. It will lead you to hate some that you were in love with, in business with, in family with. It will cause you to be so divided that you move from love to hating them. It's a trap, like catching a bird. So don't let the times make you offended. Don't get offended. You can be angry, but don't get offended. Say it with me, it's a trap. So watch this. Then he says, but lawlessness. No. He says, and then many false prophets will rise up. False prophets. What is a false prophet? I'll just put it in here. I'll just put it right in here. One who in God's name teaches what is false. False prophet. I love to see your heads down taking notes. A false prophet is one who in God's name teaches what is false. Then he says, and because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. The ones who loved, their love will grow cold because of lawlessness. Definition of lawlessness is iniquity. Lawlessness is iniquity. What is iniquity? Iniquity is when you know what to do is right and you decide not to do it. I'm just not going to do it. I'm not doing it. I'm not doing it. It goes against what I feel. I don't like him and I'm not going to like him. I'm going to hate him. And God says, I want you to love him. I want you to love him. I'm not going to do it. I'm going to ignore those verses in the Bible. Lawlessness is when you decide how to interpret what God says and you make a decision not to obey. Well, I'm making this choice because of these reasons. I'm not going to do that because of these reasons. And the question is, what did God say? Hey, Martin, I'm in a lot of meetings. I'm in a lot of meetings. I'm in a lot of meetings. I'm in a lot of Zoom calls. I had 8 on Friday. What are we going to do about this? How do we feel about that? Where are we going to go? I'm the only pastor, teacher, leader, minister, whatever you want to call it on the call. CEOs, top levels of city government in our state and in our city on the Zoom call. I'm not saying nothing until something unrighteous comes up. Well, Martin, this is what you should be doing. This is how you should behave during these times. And I'm saying, I don't know what y'all saying. I respect all of you, billionaires, multimillionaires, leading corporations, have powerful positions in the government, but I serve a different government. And I've got to do what my government says, because if I get into iniquity, I don't know about you. But if I get into iniquity, I know what's going to happen to my life. My life gets in danger when I do iniquity. When God tells me to do something and I do something. Okay, y'all don't want to talk to me today. But when I won't talk about you, I'll talk about me. When I do something opposite. If I start to divide and not unify, I know it's going to happen to me. So it's not that I won't do it. I can. Say it with me. The one thing I'm not going to do, I'm not going to walk in iniquity. I mean, I'm not going to pray to God and him tell me what to do, and then I'm going to say no. Now, you bad if you can do that. I mean, you got guts to tell God no. God told me to sit here for a minute. I'm 6 feet from you. You's a bad person if you can tell God no. You got some stuff I don't got. I'm scared of you. Let's not hang out. If that's who you are, don't call me. Unfriend me today. Unfollow me today. I can't hang out. I can't do it. My life is in danger. I'm sitting on top of a mountain right now. It's open season on people like me. I'm in a world I shouldn't be in. I can't be hanging out with folks that ain't trying to obey God. Well, I'm not going to obey God. You want to go golfing? Heck no, I don't want to go golfing with you. Don't invite me to dinner. I mean, don't talk to me. Well, I'm not sure. I'm trying to find out if I can obey God. I don't want to be with you either. If you stuck on the fence and you straddling in the fence walking, one day you're going to hit a fence post. Am I clear? Can't hang out with you. I'm climbing a mountain. Can't hang out with you. There's got to be yes people walking with me. People who are not confused. They know exactly what God's trying to do right now, and they're just saying, I want to be a part of it. You bad if you can do that. Last verse. In this chapter. Deep verse. Read it now. And this gospel. And then he names what it is. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached. It's not maybe. This gospel, not the gospel of faith, just told us, not the gospel of healing, not the gospel of prosperity, not the gospel of salvation. I'm waiting on a sermon, a preacher told me. I said, stop waiting, read the Bible. You ain't got to wait on no sermon. God ain't got to speak to you. Preach the same sermon. Preach Matthew 24 for 25 years. You'll be good. I'm waiting on the Lord. It's in red. Forget these other guys. Forget Paul. Forget Peter. Forget all of them. Just read what's in red. We cool. Well, Paul said the women aren't smart. I said, we wouldn't talk about Paul telling women to sit down in church. We're talking about the kingdom. You can't believe Paul, he had a problem with women. He had a lot of them before he got saved. And he decided when he got saved, I'm not doing that no more. Now you're going to take something Paul said and make it your doctrine. Men, y'all know, okay, I'm off script. Men, y'all know before you got saved, you were bad. You know you were bad, you needed God in your life. The men are looking down in their mask, can't even see them. They look at, you knew you needed a God to help you. You were wrong. And you treated women wrong. So Paul said, now that I'm saved, I'm going to give the rest of my life to God because I really mess up some women. So when he says, be quiet, he had an issue with them. Okay, y'all. So, and this gospel, we don't have time for that today. Family series in November. So, and this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all nations. And then the end will come. Gospel. I'm defining all these words for you so you don't have to guess. Check me out. Gospel means good news. But when people say I'm preaching the good news, you have to ask them which one. Hey, Martin, I got good news. What is it? So when someone says I'm preaching the good news, say, what is it? If they say anything except kingdom, be a good Jamaican man. Throw it, crush it up and throw it away, man. It is trash. Because it's not what he said to do. So the kingdom is the kingship, sovereignty, authority. Let's go quick. It's the rulership of God, both in the world and in men's hearts. That's what the word kingdom means in that sentence. Preach the rulership of Christ. Preach the kingship of Jesus. That Jesus is more than Lord and Savior. He's king. Then the word preach means proclaimed with authority. Because to him who endures to the end shall be saved. Proclaim it with authority. What does world mean? World is literally the Greek word cosmos, but it simply means in every system. In every system. Every system needs the gospel of the kingdom. Banking needs the gospel of the kingdom. Education needs the gospel of the kingdom. Business needs the gospel of the kingdom. Family needs the gospel of the kingdom. In our city, there are 6 or 7 blocks dedicated to show humans how to treat animals. The Center of Humane Treatment. And millions of dollars go into this fund to teach you how to treat a cat. Yeah, I'm coming. Y'all know I'm coming. Name one place in the entire country, and there are one of these centers in every city. Every city has one. As a matter of fact, during the pandemic, they were empty. Every cat, every mouse, every hamster, every snake, every goldfish was gone to that center and taken out. Because people would rather talk to cats and dogs and goldfish than they'd rather talk to people. Name one center in America that's there to teach us how to treat one another. So you got to preach it in every system. You're not in that system just to be hanging out there. You're there to proclaim the kingdom. Let me finish here. You've got to be a witness. This is my point. A witness, the Greek word moritorium, means, read them, evidence, testimony, proof. What is it? One more time. Jesus says, this gospel of the kingdom is going to be proclaimed in all the world, and eventually there's going to be a witness. There's going to be evidence of it. There's going to be a testimony of it, and there's going to be proof of it. Before Jesus comes, there will be a place in our society where the kingdom is felt, seen, and experienced. There's going to be a place in the world where there's peace in the neighborhoods and on the streets, where poverty does not exist, where hunger does not exist, where pestilence are not there. Prove it to you in just a minute. He has done it several times in the Bible. We just never noticed it. He proved before they came out of Exodus, out of Egypt, what it's going to be like. Y'all hear? But first, let me show you this. So now, every nation, every race, every people, put that up. And then what is the end? The end is, once the gospel of the kingdom is preached, it is the principal end and aim and purpose of God. So once we get this done, the end comes. So here's the truth about it. The end is not dependent upon earthquakes. The end is not dependent upon tribulation, wars, pestilence, crisis, or ISIS. The end will come when we finish our assignment. So what we got to deal with is the question, what is our assignment? And I think I just gave it to you. We have to preach the gospel of the King until it is felt, seen, and evident. Proclaim it everywhere we go until people can say, oh, that's different. That's the kingdom. Now watch this now. We preach everything except the kingdom. We talk about everything except the kingdom. But let me prove what I'm saying. Go to 1 Peter 3:19. Just go ahead and put it up on the screen. Put it up on the screen. And this is from the Passion Bible, I believe. It read clearer, I think, so that we can all understand it. When he went in the spirit realm, it's talking about God waiting. So when he went into the spirit realm and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison because of their disobedience a long time ago. In other words, when Jesus was crucified, he went to the heart of the earth, or hell, or whatever you want to call it, where Satan was. He had an assignment there. He took keys. He led captivity captive. He led some people who were in hell, everybody there he preached the gospel to and gave them a transfer. If they wanted it. So he's there preaching the gospel of the kingdom. He takes the keys. Then he starts fussing at those who are alive during Noah's days. I'll prove it. Y'all like, I don't read that. Let me read it for you then. So there were people who lived in iniquity long ago, disobedience. I told you to do this, you didn't do it. Here it is. For during the time of Noah. Is that up behind me? So during the time of what? When are we talking about? Now, specifically. The time of Noah. What happened? When God did what? What did God do? Talk to me. What did he do? God himself waited. Doesn't make sense, does it? Why did he wait? God waited until the ark was prepared. Now Jesus is fussing at those who were supposed to help Noah build it. Jesus said, you disobeyed. I told you to help him build this ark. And Noah, you took a 3-month project and made it how long? 120. You took a project I wanted to help you get done in under a year. You turned it into 100. But I could not send the rain. Why? Why couldn't I send the rain? Why couldn't God send the rain? It's not that he didn't want to send the rain. He could not send the rain. Because why? There was no ark. They had not finished their assignment. They had not done what they were told to do. And let me tell you something, Sugar Lump and Honey Pie. There are some things God wants to bring to you in your life, but you have not finished the assignment. If he did it now in your life, it would be wasted. You are not ready. You are not prepared. You don't have an ark. You don't have a strategy. You don't have an attitude. You're still crying over what happened. You're still talking about people who left your life a long time ago. You're still blaming people. You got to throw that away and figure out, how do I take advantage and finish the assignment on my life? If I'm supposed to build an ark, I'm going to focus on the ark. Shout with me. I got to keep my focus. Because everything God wants to do with you, he's waiting patiently for you to finish. God responds to your action. Pastor Neil said it this way. God reacts to your action. He waited patiently for Noah to finish. And then everybody didn't come in. So he's fussing at the few. The reason y'all down here dead is because you didn't do it. If you had just done what Noah told y'all, I wouldn't be fussing at you. Your walk of iniquity led you to this place. Now, I'm giving you a free card to migrate to the heavenly courts instead of being in hell. And you know all of them didn't go with him? Y'all religious people, y'all hard, man. Y'all believe stuff even if it's burning you up. I'm amazed. Bruh, you're not sleeping at night. You know you're living unrighteously. You know this system you're leading is not right. You know it in your heart. That's me at the table. Are you sleeping at night, my brother? You got bags under your eyes. What's going on? Having a hard time resting. It's because God is dealing with you about this stuff you built to manage people. Can we fix that? I can show you how to get some sleep. Oh, you're going to pray for me? No. I'm going to ask you to let that go. As soon as you let that go, righteousness and peace will enter your life. Well, that would make sense, preacher, but I'm getting divorced now. Let me tell you why you're getting divorced. You're getting divorced because there's a God that's wanting to use you, and he's already spoken to you. You're not saved, but you're having dreams. You're having what you call nightmares. They're not nightmares, they're dreams. And it's God showing you how he's going to kill everything you built. This little thing may be worth $10 billion, but now there's fear in your heart that it's all going to be ripped out of your hands. I'm trying to tell you how it won't be ripped out of your hands. You need to share with your fellow man. You need to feed the hungry. You need to take care of the prisoner. You need to invite the foreigner into your house. And this is how you keep it. Where are you getting this from? From the same Bible your preacher preaches from every Sunday. He just won't preach that part. So I gotta
move on. I gotta get done because I want you to do something for me. Let's go quickly to 1 Peter 2 and 9.
Tell your neighbor, I want you to believe. I want you to believe. I want you to believe. Tell your neighbor, I want you to believe. I want you to believe that you are the witness. You were the minister last week. This week, you're the witness. Come on, let's read real quick. 1 Peter 2 and 9. Read it with me. But you are a chosen generation, A. Come on, y'all. A peculiar people. That what? That ye should show. You show it. You show it. You show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into light. Exodus 9. You are peculiar. You're peculiar. You're peculiar people. You don't walk in darkness. And God's getting ready to use you in a way you've never seen. All of you. Exodus 9, 3 and 4. Come on, read it. And the Lord will make a difference between the livestock of Israel and the livestock of Egypt, so nothing shall die of all that belong to the children of Israel. I say that none, not one of us will die of this virus, this pestilence. Not one of us will go poor. Not one of us will lose anything. We're going to come out of this thing bigger, better than ever before. We're going to come out richer. We're going to come out more powerful. Somebody shout, not one. Why? Because God said to Israel, Joshua, he said it, Linnell. He said it, Callie. He said it. I'm going to make a difference between your house and your neighbor's house. I'm going to show people what a witness looks like. I'm going to make a difference between you and them. I'm going to protect you against the pestilence. I'm going to protect you against the famine, everything that's happening out there. I'm going to keep you. Then they're going to knock on your door. Who are you people? Who are you people? Why do you have such joy? Why do you have such peace? Why are you always smiling? Why does it look like you're getting a full night's sleep? And you'll be able to tell them, I'm a kingdom citizen. I'm a peculiar person. My job is to be a witness to you. During the pandemic, I paid off my house. During the pandemic, my son had another grandchild for me. During the pandemic, God lifted me up. During the pandemic, God healed our marriage. During the pandemic, God healed my body. During the pandemic, I started a business. During the pandemic, hey, y'all, I'm telling you. Watch this now. Go to the 10th verse of Exodus 23. Bless his name. Bless his name. Bless his name. Bless his name. Hallelujah. This is in Egypt. This is the miracle. There was darkness in Egypt, but let's see what happened with the children of Israel. Right across the street. The Egyptians, it says of them, they did not, couldn't even see one another in their house. So dark. Depression's everywhere, y'all.
How many counselors are in the room? How many of you psychologists, sociologists, counselors? Raise your hand. I tell you the truth. All these counselors are booked from morning to night because there's depression everywhere. Fear. Everybody's afraid. Everybody needs to go talk to somebody. And I'm telling them you just need to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Let's read it. They did not see one another, nor did anyone even get up out of the chair they were sitting in. They didn't rise from his place for 3 days. But all the children of Israel had light. Would you please describe this God to me? I'm sorry. Would you please describe him? Because I don't get this God. I don't understand how the house next to me is in total dark. How is the house next to me in total darkness and I got light? What kind of God is this? Who is he? The biggest fight I got into after being a Christian almost came to blows. I was in my dorm room. And the evangelist knocked on my dorm door, but I just got saved, really, got baptized in the Holy Ghost. He knocked on my door, and he wanted to tell me about a God. Martin, you're going to go through some things, and God's going to leave you alone, and you're going to feel lonely. And I told him, if you don't get away from the front of my door, I'm going to knock the teeth out of your mouth. You ain't going to have a rock in your head till I get through with you. He said, why are you so angry with me? You told me you were saved. And I said, I don't want to meet him. I don't want to know nothing about that God. I don't want to know nothing about a God that'll leave me by myself. I need to believe where I am right now, that if I make my bed in hell, there will be a God that's there with me, that even when I'm alone and about to kill myself, that there will be a God that meets me. I don't want to meet a God that can't help me. I don't want to meet a God that cannot lift me up. I want a God that when I'm in the dark, he can bring me some light. I want a God that when I'm hungry, he can feed me. I want a God that when I'm alone, he'll say with me, Mother Woods, Pastor Linnell, the Bible says and the song says, for he walks with me. He talks with me. He tells me that I am his own. That's the kind of God I need. And that's the kind of God I got. I was reading, wasn't I? I was. What was I reading? Okay. I'm going to get through. I'm going to get through. Okay, just one more. Psalm 91. Watch yourself. Hold on to your teeth and your weave right now. Oh, yeah. I know there's an enemy in the land. I ain't stupid. I know some people are losing. They're losing their jobs, losing their houses, losing their money. They're losing their families. I know it. I see it. It's all around me. It's everywhere. I can't ignore it. I can't ignore the looks on people's faces everywhere I go. I get it. But I'm in a different place, and I'm going to read to you where I'm at. Here it is. If you got the guts and the intestinal fortitude and just a little swag in your spirit, you ought to say these words. 1,000 may. A thousand may fall at my right side and 10,000 at my right hand. But it shall not come near. That was it. You have 60 seconds. Go ahead and praise him. Hey. Okay. It's not coming to my house because I'm a witness. It's not coming to my house. I'm not accepting it in my house. I'm saying, no, you can't come in here. You can't do that in my house. You can't tear down my house. You can't tear down my family. No, no, no. I'm telling you, there's the light of God here. There's a demarcation line. And even if I go through something, it will not take me out.